Hi, welcome to Matt's Basement Workshop. Before we start today's episode, let's take a moment to talk about safety. Remember to read and understand all the safety information that comes with all of your power tools. Not only will it make you a safer woodworker, but in the long run it'll make you a better woodworker. Next, remember to wear some sort of eye protection. We need something to keep our eyes protected from any of the sawdust and debris that could be flying around our shop. Next, wear some sort of hearing protection. Remember, we need to protect our hearing from all the loud noises in the shop, because once your hearing's gone, it's never coming back. So, with all that said, let's move on to this episode. Okay, today's episode, we're going to be talking about using a cross-cutting saw, a hand saw, very much like this, to cross-cut our lumber down to the rough dimensions. Now, the reason why I'm going to use a hand saw today is because a lot of the planks that I have are much wider than my power miter saw, and so therefore, I have to make a couple of different cuts on the power miter saw to get all the way through the wood, or I could try and put them on my table saw using the sled, but the boards, since they tend to be about 6 feet or longer, that makes it a little awkward. So, as I mentioned in earlier episodes of the podcast, the audio podcast, sometimes bringing the tool to the wood is a lot safer than bringing the wood to the tool. Okay, now the next thing to think about when it comes to choosing a hand saw is, how many teeth are there? Remember, we need to think about teeth per inch. Just like with our table saw and our miter saw, you're going to have a specialized cross-cutting saw, and that's what this one is. This one has about 12 to 15 teeth per inch. Now, it doesn't make a very fast cut, but what it does is it makes a very clean cut. It still needs to be cleaned up just a little bit more, and I usually use a block plane for that. Or again, I'll maybe like use a sander or, well, something along that line. But right now, I'm just using this to get to rough dimensions. Unlike a table saw or a miter saw, the blade is really, really thin. I think this is probably about maybe, it's less than a 16th of an inch, I know that. So we waste less wood when we use it. Okay, now when you go to use your hand saw, hand placement is very important. You can hold it here, but that's all, see how it's going to kind of, when you're cutting, it's going to kind of wiggle a little bit. Take your finger, point it straight out. And the nice thing is this one kind of, it's inset so that my finger fits better. And you're actually going to kind of point it. Where your finger is pointing, that's where it's going to go. But also to help, here, let's take the saw blade guard off. Using the thumb of your other hand, you kind of place it on the wood. And I'll show you this when I actually make a cut. And use your thumb to help guide the beginning of the cut. And this is what's going to help you make a nice straight cut. Okay, now what I want to show you here is, I went ahead and made up two sawhorses, basically, but these are at the right height for me so that when I go to cut, you want to be bent over the work and bring the saw down and let gravity work for you so that it's pushing through. If you're way up here, way up above, like at a bench, you're going to kind of struggle a little bit and you're really going to have to use more of your muscle. Let nature take effect and down it goes. And here you notice the wood is supported on either side so you don't have to worry about it fumbling. And as I'll show you, by dropping your knee onto the wood and then pushing, it holds the wood in perfectly, no need for a vise. Okay, this board is one of the boards that we're going to be using for a side panel. But the problem is, I can't cut it on the miter saw because it's about 9 inches wide, and the widest that my miter saw will accept is an 8-inch board. I mean, I could cut it, but it would take a couple of passes, and this is actually kind of a longer board, and the table saw won't cut it. So we're going to use the hand saw. Now, the first thing is finger placement. Finger should point straight out. It's going to be working as a guide. Thumb. It's going to line up right at the line. We're going to use the thumb as a guide. Don't cut it. Establish that first cut. Make sure your board is properly supported. And follow through. Again, using your thumb as a guide through the whole thing. Occasionally blow the sawdust out of the way. Keep it going. Once the kerf has been established, the saw is just going to follow. You can make minor adjustments if you feel you need to. And voila, it's all cut. And that's it. Okay, using the technique that I showed you just a second ago, we converted all that lumber, all the cherry that was sitting over there in the lumber rack, to this pile right here. Now, there are a few offcuts, but essentially, that's all of the cherry lumber that we had purchased for this project. That entire stack, and remember all the lumber that was over in the rack, it's about 33 board feet, and we've converted it all to this in about maybe 10, maybe 15 minutes. Once you get a good pace going, it's nothing to rip right through all of it. Well, cross-cut through it, actually, to be the better term, to get through all this lumber. When the lines are all drawn out and you just knew exactly where to go, the hardest part was moving one piece to another, and that's why I have these stools down here to help me store it
or to place the lumber. And if you notice, all that around the stools, that's the waste. That's the sawdust that we got from it. And it didn't go up in the air. It didn't get into our lungs that much. In fact, we blew most of it out of the way. And there was almost no noise. The only noise you got was, well, the occasional customer when we hit a knot. Okay, I'm just going to show you this here. Since we're doing the rough dimensioning, this piece is going to make up one of the side panels of Aiden's dresser. Now, what I've done is I've rough cut it, as I showed you previously how to do it with the handsaw. I now have an aluminum straight edge over the top. And that part right there, you see that light shining through it? Well, I have a light on the other side to represent where the edge is not straight. This edge hasn't been jointed yet. And actually, see that thing right there? That's the bottom of my number 7 Stanley jointer. I don't have a power jointer in my workshop. I have a thickness planer, but when it comes to jointing, well, I use my number 7, and I really like it because I feel like I have a lot of control over the wood. So, what I need to do now is I need to get that edge straightened out. And the next time we see this piece, you probably won't see that light shining through. So I'm going to show you how I take care of that next.
Okay, as I mentioned, I don't have a power jointer, but I do have this. This is my number 7 Stanley jointer plane, and it has a very long body. It's about it's 24 inches, I do believe. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to run it along this edge. I've got the grain going in the right direction, and we'll talk about that more later on in another podcast. But what I end up doing is I want to get this edge cleaned up. So for a jointer fence, I use my thumb and my forefinger. I wrap it on here. I put this on, push down on the front, follow through. It's almost like a dance. And in a short period of time, it actually starts cutting. And I can see where the wood's being removed, and I know for a fact this edge is getting jointed.
Okay, now it's literally taken maybe 2 minutes or so to run the whole entire length, and again, I have a light on the other side, but you don't see it shining through. And this edge is jointed and it's ready to move onto the table saw to have the other end cut. Because just like a regular power jointer, you're not going to joint both edges. You joint one edge, then run it through the table saw to get it to the dimension that you want. And then if you really want to, you could touch up the freshly cut side with the jointer again. Now, I'm going to show you a neat trick when it comes to gluing up these two panels. So I'll show you that in just a second.
Okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to cut the width of the board to the rough dimension now that we've jointed one edge nice and straight. Now the blade is raised up enough so that it's about potentially a quarter of an inch above the wood. And for clarity of purposes, I removed the blade guard on this one. So we're going to be extra careful as we're pushing through. So now that we're all set, the fence is locked in position, hearing protection's on. Push block for as we get closer to the blade. Let's go ahead and make the cuts. Start the wood back a little bit. Gently feed in. Keep yourself back to the wood. Always watch your finger. Keep going. Our hand is far away from the blade that I feel here. Get there. Almost done.
Okay, so I've made the complete cut, and you definitely couldn't hear me over the blade, but my hand was far enough away from the blade that I felt comfortable continuing the pressure of pushing the wood up against the fence. Remember, you need, since you have that straight edge, take advantage of it. Push it directly up against the fence as it's going. Now, you notice I hesitated a little bit, and this is cherry. It burns really easy. There's where I hesitated. But that's okay. We're going to clean this up, actually, with another hand plane or with your jointer. And actually, considering that since this is a panel, it's going to be glued up in the middle anyways. But we now have a second edge that's straight and pretty much flat and ready to be glued up. So that's what we're going to head to next once we glue up the other panels, or other pieces for the panel, I should say. Okay, so now what we've done is we had one edge jointed, if you remember. We then moved on to the table saw, in which we cut the board to the rough dimension that we wanted, the right width. And these two boards actually are going to make up one panel. And in fact, I'll show you how I came to the decision about the grain pattern. But since I put them one on top of the other, to give me the idea what the panel is going to look like, what I need to do now is to glue them together. But notice, you can kind of see right there again, I put the light back there and you see that gap right there? Well, we need to close that up. And there's really kind of a neat way to do it. We can run it on our jointer, but as I said, I only have that hand plane. So I'm going to show you something you can do with the hand plane that will take care of that And it's really easy, and it just takes a matter of minutes. All right, I'll show you in just 1 second. Okay, I'm going to show you something kind of neat. These two boards are going to make up one side panel. Now, what I want to do is I want the glue line to be a perfect mirror image. So here's the two sides. These are the ones that are going to be sitting together that are going to make up the glue line. Now, when I had the boards out, the glue line wasn't quite perfect where I wanted it. So now I'm going to do a kind of a neat trick with my hand jointer and bring them into the same exact plane. They're going to be a perfect mirror image once I'm done. So what I've actually done here, this setup, the two boards were out flat, one right next to the other, and then I proceeded to fold it, much like a sandwich, so that on the inside here, actually, are the two faces that I want facing out, and then here's the glue line that's going to, or the joint that's going to make up that glue line. So let's see how we do that.
Okay, I'm going to use my number 7. Now, you could usually use a jack plane, a number 5, or, you know, I guess you could probably try to use a number 4, but the longer body makes it just that much easier. So I'm going to start at this end, and I'm going to start pushing through all the way to the edge. Again. And the idea is to hit both boards. When we're all done, this should be a perfect mirror image. Okay, now after doing all that work with the edge, and that really literally only took a couple of minutes, I have essentially what's a sprung joint. Now, this one board's a little twisted, but it's totally usable for what we want to do with this panel. So I just push down a little bit, apply some pressure here, come over here, push this one down. And actually, I'm not too worried about it because when I come back, once this is all glued up, I will just simply be able to use a hand plane, come right down the center, clean up that edge, and it's going to look nice and tight. But if you notice, I only have clamps here in the middle, and the edges, especially this one, that one's a mirror image, closes itself right up. This is a sprung joint, and these are the only clamps I need for this. Okay, let's do the actual glue up. Taking some fresh glue, get it to the tip, just enough glue along the edge here. Don't really want to apply too much, just going to come back, work it in. Okay, side to the side, bring the piece down, do a bit of a, it's called a rub joint, get that in place. And here, since we have a sprung joint, we just simply bring it right up. These are those quick clamps that allow you to make some quick adjustments. Okay, there's that one. And here comes this one. Now what I've done is I've raised the board up off of the table to make it easier for the clamps to be adjusted. And this one's just about ready to go.
Okay, so this is our results after gluing up all of the panels. I have the first one over here is side panel B, or excuse me, side panel A. This one is side panel B, and this is actually going to make up the top. Now, all three were glued up. We used sprung joints on all the pieces. In fact, this panel right here was made up of 1, 2, and 3 pieces. These are all rough sizes. So the next step is simply going to be doing that. We're going to take it down to the finished sizes that we want. They're all oversized right now to, you know, give us a chance to figure out where we want to make our cuts, what we're going to remove. The setup time on these, it only took, once everything was planed up and ready to go, only a few minutes to get everything going, and they sat in the clamps for, I let them sit for an hour. The recommended time from the particular glue manufacturer I used said they were ready in 30 minutes. So that's it.
Okay, so that's going to do it for Matt's Basement Workshop for the second video of Aiden's Dresser. Now, the next video I'm planning on working on some of the finishing dimensions, the finished ones, kind of go through how to set those up and everything and a few tricks and stuff. And that's about it. One thing, remember, if you haven't checked out the audio podcast, you might as well check something over. I got a little bit of a surprise, but hey, what the heck, I'll tell you right now, maybe this will be the one you want to watch, and you'll just skip over that. I've got some great swag, so go ahead and enter your name. More importantly, I received a fantastic 5-piece turning set from Woodcraft to give away to one of my lucky listeners. It could be you. Go ahead and put your name in the entry, and check, you know, go over and go to the website, mattsbasementworkshop.com, and I should have a picture of them up there. If not, go to Woodcraft, and it's a pinnacle turning set. It's a beginner set, so it's fantastic. So anyways, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.